Welcome, everybody. I am pleased to welcome you to the first external event of the Canadian Dementia Learning and Resource Network, or CDLRN for short. My name is Laura Middleton, and I am the co-research lead of CDLRN alongside Carrie McCaney, who will also be speaking here today. Joining us is Myrna Norman, a member of our Community Advisory Committee and a person living with dementia. She's also a representative of two of our project teams. Today, we'll introduce CDLRN and our work to bring together and support our incredible network of project teams that are all working together to improve the well-being of people living with dementia and their partners in care. I'm going to speak in French here for a moment. Mais avant de commencer, j'aimerais diriger tous ceux qui préféreraient écouter en français vers le bas de l'écran. Vous verrez un bouton d'interprétation. En cliquant sur la flèche, vous pouvez choisir l'audio français. The Canadian Dementia Learning and Resource Network is hosted by the Schlegel University of Waterloo Research Institute for Aging. We acknowledge that the RIA, as well as my home and workplace at the University of Waterloo, is situated on the traditional territory of the Neutral, Anishinaabe, and Haudenosaunee peoples. The RIA is also situated on the Haldimand Tract, the land promised to the Six Nations that includes 6 miles on each side of the Grand River. We further acknowledge that many other nations are represented here today at this meeting. We hold deep respect for Indigenous histories and a commitment to build relationships that enhance and better serve the needs of Indigenous people and all others experiencing dementia or partnering in their care. Today, Carrie, Myrna, and I and the project teams have the pleasure of speaking on behalf of CDLRN. But I would be amiss to not mention the incredible CDLRN staff that make everything happen. Francis Morton Chang, Danielle Chrisman, and Nathan Hansberger. We're lucky to have such a team of skilled and passionate individuals supporting this work. And I'd also like to acknowledge that CDLRN, as well as our member project teams, are funded by the Public Health Agency of Canada under their Dementia Community Investment. However, the information and views that we present today do not necessarily represent the views of the Public Health Agency of Canada. Today, we have a busy schedule. We will start with a short presentation by Carrie McCaney, Myrna Norman, and myself about the context for the Canadian Dementia Learning and Resource Network, as well as its value, goals, and impact. Speaking in this, then we will hear about the important work of two of our project teams, the Evaluating Co-Design Tools for Strong Partnerships in the Dementia Care Triad, and the Living with Dementia in Rural First Nations Communities, a Health and Wellness Project. We'll follow this with a question and answer period. Please feel free to enter any questions that come up during the presentations in the Q&A feature at any time. Our CDLRN team will be monitoring the questions so they're ready for the question and answer period. And then we'll finish with closing remarks from Carrie McCaney. Please note that we're recording this presentation for future sharing, but you won't be seen on screen during that recording. And now I'll hand it over to Carrie to introduce CDLRN.
Wonderful, thanks so much, Laura, and welcome everyone. So I'd like to start by providing just some context. Canada's first national dementia strategy was launched in June of 2019. And the vision of this strategy is a Canada in which all people living with dementia and caregivers are valued and supported, quality of life is optimized, and dementia is prevented, well understood, and effectively treated. So building on this vision, we have three national objectives: to prevent dementia, to try and advance therapies and find a cure for dementia, and also to improve the quality of life for people living with dementia and their family and friend caregivers. Our focus today will be on improving quality of life. So through the dementia strategy, the Public Health Agency of Canada has made a number of investments. This includes the Dementia Community Investment, which is sometimes called the DCI. Currently, there are 19 projects, dementia community investment projects that have been funded. These community-based projects are developing, testing, and scaling up programs and resources that aim to improve well-being for people living with dementia and caregivers, and increase knowledge about the factors that it can influence the risk of developing dementia. And in addition to funding the dementia community investment projects, the Public Health Agency of Canada also funds the Canadian Dementia Learning and Resource Network, as Laura had mentioned, CDLRN. The role of CDLRN is to support the dementia community investment projects. So we work collaboratively and synergistically with the projects to achieve this goal. And finally, a community advisory committee has been established, which includes persons living with dementia and caregivers. And that committee provides advice and guidance to our CDLRN team. CDLRN supports a vibrant pan-Canadian collective of dementia community investment projects. And it's amazing to see the projects that are included in this. They range in terms of the focus of the project, in terms of their geography, and also in terms of the communities they work with. And as Laura mentioned, we're fortunate enough to be hearing from two of these projects today. Now, despite this diversity, the projects share some common goals. First, to reduce stigma and change attitudes about dementia. Second, to work to improve knowledge and skills related to dementia and how to support those who are impacted by dementia. And third, to increase the physical and social well-being of persons living with dementia and caregivers. So these projects share a number of these goals as they work towards their unique activities. I'm now going to turn it over to Myrna to talk about the engagement of people living with dementia in CDLRN.
Thank you, Carrie. I'm really pleased to be here as a person with dementia, feeling as an equal to everyone else. We can tell that dementia care and concern and actual help is really going ahead. The Public Health Agency of Canada funds these projects, as we were told earlier, under the banner of the Dementia Community Investment Project. The projects that you are about to hear of are vital to me as a person with a dementia. Persons with dementia still in 2022 face barriers such as participating in their own communities and accessing supports that other Canadians take for granted. The Dementia Community Investments Project support my participation as a member in my community to experience the programs and services that improve my well-being. To be truly successful, though, these projects understand that it is essential to have our voices at the table, not just as participants, but as members of the team. helping projects and the Dementia Community Investment Projects to create programs, services, and communities that meet the needs of persons living with dementia and support living well. We are members of the project teams and we serve as advisors to these projects. With Canadian Dementia Learning and Resource Network, people living with dementia are part of the planning and working committees that help it direct the work of the network. We are playing key roles in all aspects of the Canadian Dementia Learning and Resource Network, and we will help to ensure its success. Now here's Laura to talk about the activities of the Canadian Dementia Learning and Resource Network. I think Laura is here.
Inevitably, someone had to forget to unmute. So let me start again. Our CDLRN team of five staff is complemented by all the groups that Carrie and Myrna just mentioned. Our work would not be possible without the Community Advisory Committee, which includes Myrna, as they provide input and guidance on all our major decisions, nor without the diverse expertise and skills of the project teams. The overarching aim of CDLRN is to accelerate and amplify the successes of the project teams. We do this in three ways. We build and strengthen relationships across the project teams to create a vibrant, nationwide, collaborative network with shared goals, as Carrie mentioned earlier. The teams can then learn from each other's experiences and leverage each other's expertise towards their own projects. We also build the capacity of the teams to implement, evaluate, and spread community-based initiatives to improve the well-being of people living with dementia. Oftentimes, this involves identifying members from within our networks to share their knowledge. Finally, and this one is just starting up as our projects begin to mature, we aim to share and spread the successes of our member projects. I hope all of you on the call will stay tuned in the coming months and years as we have more stories, successes, and lessons learned to share and spread across the country. Importantly, the relationships, knowledge, and skills that we gain through our network won't only last through the term of the projects. In each project site, the project teams, the people affected who participate will retain and build on their learnings to affect future projects, future relationships, and their communities. Our community at CDLRN is one that is committed to change, to overcoming stigma, to promote inclusion, participation, and well-being of people living with dementia. And we hope this passion and knowledge will spread to their communities and beyond. With that, I am pleased to be able to introduce the first of two project teams that are presenting here today. We have Valentina Cardozo from SE Health, who is presenting on behalf of her project, evaluating co-design tools for strong partnerships in the dementia care triad. Valentina.
Thank you so much for the introduction and for the opportunity to be here today. So I am very excited to tell you about our project, but before I dive into the work, I just want to acknowledge the other investigators for this project, which include Dr. Paul Holyoke, Dr. Justine Giosa, Dr. Heather McNeil, Dr. Anna Neely, Doris Warner, and Karthika Yogaranthan. I also want to take a moment to gratefully acknowledge the traditional territories in which I live and work, as Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabeg, and the traditional land of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. SE Health is proud of their longstanding commitment to working in partnership with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis communities all across Canada, which honors, respects, and acts upon the work of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Now, we can, perfect. To start, I just wanted to show you the framework that we use for this project, which is called Participatory Research to Action. And what this framework does is that it combines the rigor of science and the creativity of design, bringing research through design together with design through research. And today I will be talking about each of the phases up until where we are today. Oops, scroll back there. There we go. So this all started with the collaboration of the Alzheimer's Society of Canada. And what we did was that we brought together persons living with dementia, caregivers, and care providers to identify issues that challenge strong working relationships among them. It was acknowledged that a fair bit of the work had been done and tools and approaches had been developed to nurture partnerships between persons living with dementia and their paid care providers based on the principles of person-centered care. But what was less developed were tools and resources for bringing together the combined wisdom and knowledge of paid care providers and family or friend caregivers. Although they have the same focus on the person living with dementia, their patterns of working together are not supported as well as they could be. And so what we heard was that there is a need to negotiate care roles, as both care providers and caregivers can provide personal and medical care and can provide emotional and psychological care with and for the person living with dementia. But who does what and what counts in this negotiation? Is emotional support part of dementia care, and is one kind of care only for care providers and another one for caregivers? We also heard that the place of care plays a really important role. When a person living with dementia is living in their own home, the care provider is kind of like the invited guest of the person and their caregiver. And when a person with dementia is living in a long-term care home, their caregiver is sort of the invited guest. And so, to specifically identify the needs and potential tools that would bring care providers and caregivers closer together, we held a series of 6 workshops, 2 with care providers, 2 with caregivers, and 2 with a combined group. And what we did during these workshops was that we explored the current experience of caregivers and care providers, and then started to think through or to ideate potential responses to gaps to the experience of collaboration. From there, we prototyped tools, instruments, and formats for bringing care providers and caregivers closer together. Some of the tools that we looked at were already in existence, like the All About Me document from the Alzheimer's Society of Canada, and others were developed, like the Top 5 Things tool, both of which are illustrated on the slide. So what we heard from this workshop is that the experiences of the connections between care providers and caregivers are not always easy to make happen successfully, especially because their time together is not unlimited. However, what we did find was common ground that at the heart of their desire was to maintain the personhood of the person living with dementia, even if they didn't use that language. But the key to any tool to help them work together is to reflect that there are changes over time that don't allow a static or a one-time tool, but instead a tool that provides a space to rethink and renegotiate care roles and responsibilities. So out of all of this lovely work was born our very first Dementia Journey Journal, which we affectionately refer to as the ODJJ. You can see it here, and it started with a paper tool that had lots of places to update, revise, and retell as changes occur. From there, and with funding from the Public Health Agency of Canada, we held 3 developed workshops with First Nations communities in Northern Ontario before the pandemic, as well as 1 online developed workshop with persons living with dementia and their caregivers in British Columbia in November of 2020. So the idea of this workshops was to further develop that initial prototype, the concept, the format, the content, the look and the feel. And how we started this work was that we did a test with a smaller group from these communities to make sure that the Dementia Journey Journal was at least appropriate and relevant to the community. And then we invited a larger group to take a deeper dive into all of the features and sections of our Dementia Journey Journal. So what we heard from these workshops was that people really like the contents and the activities that were in our Dementia Journey Journal, but there was a need to increase cultural safety of the resource, which we achieved with advice and guidance from community elders and knowledge keepers that participated in the workshops. There's also needs to make changes in languages, style, order, colors, images, add more information about dementia, include more space for writing down things, and develop an e-version. So that is exactly what we did. And we started developing all of these different versions and formats of our Dementia Journey Journal. So our main goal is to have a specific version of our Dementia Journey Journal that's specific to each community, and it reflects their feedback, but also to have, to the extent possible, an emerging version that's a generic, that combines all of the learnings from all of the different versions. We remain fully open to the idea that there will have to be variations, which are needed to meet the needs of a variety of different communities, like rural, remote, urban, suburban, Francophone, and First Nations. But what we are seeing so far is that the accumulating feedback is improving a generic version. And of course, as pictured here, we are developing an app that reflects the findings so far. And so I would love to give you a bit of a tour of the contents. So there is a place where you can write, record questions and answers that can flow between the members of the circle of care. There's also the About Me conversation started, which I mentioned before, and it provides an opportunity for the person living with dementia, the caregiver and care provider to get to know one another's history and preferences. There's a space to do some journaling about joyful moments, which may be useful to remember when times aren't quite so joyful, and a place to do care collages, which reflect the current situation. There's also a place to document well-being as it might change over time, and a suggested bi-weekly checking from the World Health Organization Well-Being Index. And last but not least, there is a listing of common warning signs of dementia with a place to record observations and a symptoms tracker. For one second. At the end of the journal, there's also a list of potential resources, and people can add their own resources by typing them in, or some of them can be accessed online. So this brings us to where we are today. So we're in the midst of starting the deliver and measure phases with communities that participated in the develop phase. We're starting with a group in British Columbia, as well as a group in Sagamok First Nation. And participants are given the option to try the paper version or the digital version of our Dementia Journey Journal, either using their own device or a tablet provided by us, for a period of 3 months. And we're asking them to answer a set of questions before and after the trial with the goal of measuring the impact of the adapted tool. In addition to that, we have continued our efforts to get our Dementia Journey Journal in the hands of people from various communities all across Canada to further develop the resource to meet the specific needs of those communities. Although our original plan was to do all of this work in person, due to the pandemic, we have pivoted to a virtual model, and we have been offering opportunities for interested individuals and communities to participate either through one-to-one interviews or online workshops. That leads me to our opportunities to get involved, because we are about to release the app version of our Dementia Journey Journal. And as well as we have opportunities to try out the paper version and the digital version of the journal. So if you are interested in learning more about this project, you're interested in looking at the journal, or if you know any communities that might benefit or might be interested in this work, please get in touch with us. Now, before ending my presentation, I would like to acknowledge and thank all of our wonderful collaborators. A special thanks goes to the elders and the community members from Sagamok and Thessalon First Nations, the Sault Ste. Marie Indigenous Friendship Center, and Mamoising North Shore Community Health Services, as well as the Alzheimer's Society of Canada. And lastly, our funders, the Public Health Agency of Canada and SE Health. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Valentina. You can already see recognition of the value of these resources in the chat. It sounds like an incredible process, as well as very valuable resources that ended up. So now I'm happy to introduce our second project, Living with Dementia in Rural First Nations Communities, a health and wellness project. And they will have three different speakers today: Maribel Abrenica, Aaron Moore, Emily Thorlacius, and Adrian Shingus speaking. So I'll hand it over to this project team.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for allowing us to present on our project today. My name is Maribel Abrenica, and I am the project coordinator for the University of Manitoba Living with Dementia in Rural First Nations Communities, a health and wellness project. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge that the University of Manitoba campuses are located on the original lands of Anishinaabe, Cree, Ojibwe, Oji-Cree, and Dene peoples, and on the homeland of the Métis Nation. We respect the treaties that were made on their territories, we acknowledge the harms and mistakes of the past, and we dedicate ourselves to move forward in partnership with Indigenous communities in a spirit of reconciliation and collaboration. If you could forward the slides, please, that would be great. To the next slide would be wonderful, thank you. That acknowledgement really hits home for us in this project, the partnerships with the Indigenous communities. Starting a project with the Indigenous communities, first and foremost, involves establishing a relationship of trust and safety. Especially we found with dementia, a lot of the Indigenous communities didn't understand, know, or believe it exists as it does. For them, there was no word for dementia in their language. So Dr. Reg Urbanowski, the project lead, reached out to the health directors in those communities to talk about this culturally tailored, community-led, community-driven project that will eventually lead to customized frameworks of care delivery. The community would be the one to spearhead the project, and we at the U of M would just help guide it along. From the initial eight communities we reached out to, four ended up participating in the project: Lake Manitoba, Penemutang, Opisquiat Cree Nation, or OCN, and Saguin. Then each community identified a community worker from within the community to lead the project on site. They're the ones here today that will be presenting some challenges and successes that we've experienced over the last couple of years. Of course, as it's been mentioned, COVID has impacted our ability to host in-person community gatherings, a very foundational way that Indigenous people celebrate their culture. So lockdowns, significant loss and death of loved ones, and fear of getting sick, along with connectivity issues, and this was a very big one for our project, slowed down the project. Yet we had some amazing successes in risk mitigation and education that you'll hear about today. One experience that I'll share is what we called the gift of memories, where we gave tablets to elders to record videos, stories, memories, anything really that they wanted to keep on the tablet. And following the OCAP principles, those tablets would remain within the communities. Well, it turned out with COVID, the families were actually able to use them during the pandemic to connect with relatives living with dementia in care homes when the in-person visits weren't possible. So an unintended risk mitigation, but you know what? We'll take it. It worked out well. So with that, I'll introduce Aaron Moore, who will highlight Lake Manitoba. From there, Emily Thorlacius will tell us about Penemutang. Then Adrian Shingus will talk about OCN. And finally, Tracy Guimon will share Saguin's experiences. Here's Aaron.
Hello, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Aaron Moore. I'm from the Lake Manitoba First Nation community, which is located around 147 kilometers northwest of Winnipeg, Manitoba. We are located on Treaty 2 First Nation territory. Now, with our community, we are the smallest community of the four that have joined on with the University of Manitoba. We have a population of 1,046 people. If we break it down, that's 550 adults, 443 children, and 85 elders. Out of those 85 elders, 20 are active couples that are living on reserve. Now, one of the problems that we had was with after launching our program on a social media platform was the ability to connect with the elders and for them to connect back with us because of connectivity issues. Now, we have issues with internet landscape because there's trees in the way, people cannot connect. So we had to reshift our focus, and I ended up going into the homes and introducing the project to the people, education for the people. And we just really kind of made it personalized care for elders and their families that were in the homes who had desire to listen in and try and help their loved ones and, you know, try and get them through with their dementia and their, they call it forgetfulness. There is no word for dementia where we live. And I'm not sure if I have my 2 minutes up.
Great. Thanks, Erin.
I would like to introduce Emily Thorlashes. She is from Penemutang First Nation, which is about 40 minutes north of our First Nation.
Thank you, Erin. Hello, everyone. My name is Emily Thorlashes, and I'm the community dementia worker for the Penemutang First Nation community. Our community is about 240 kilometers north of Winnipeg, and our population is a little over 2,800 with about 102 elders right now. A fun fact of our community is we have a very large river that runs right through the middle, but it never completely freezes in winter because of the current. It's so strong. So my main challenge has definitely been COVID, along with everyone else's in the world. It postponed all my social visits. It caused social isolation and declined the mental health of the elders. This made making connections virtually much harder, as most elders in the community are not tech friendly. Another challenge that I faced was the lack of information for rural dementia, but also lack of information online for dementia correlating with Indigenous peoples. However, I am grateful for the few articles I have stumbled upon targeting both topics to share that information. My successes have absolutely been my social visits. The social visits and gatherings are for dementia prevention and helps with mental health, as well as helps to support our caregivers and our elders with dementia. The idea of the home visits is to provide supports to our elders and families living with dementia. The highlight is the connections made between families. It is so touching to have someone phone you and specifically ask to speak with you, and that just lets you know that you are making a difference to them. One elder in particular, I have been grateful to have created a friendship rather than just a work relationship with her, and she has been very involved in giving feedback with ideas for our program. With her, the main focus is dementia prevention, as dementia does run in her family. My future goals would be to continue all the social visits, to put out some exercise videos, and to hopefully further the gathering of experimental research to document. So thank you. Sharing next is Adrian Shingus from Opaskwayak Bay Nation.
So I saw that Adrian was on the call a little bit earlier, but as we've mentioned, one of the experiences we're having is with connectivity. So it could be that she has not been able to have a steady internet connection. So I'll just report a little bit on what's been going on in OCN. So OCN is located near the Paw, Manitoba, approximately 626 kilometers north of Winnipeg. It's close to the Saskatchewan border. On reserve, the population is a little bit over 3,300 and off reserve approximately 2,900. And again, some of the challenges that we experienced in OCN was the COVID-19 restrictions limited outreach to our community members. So effective December 28th, 2021, OCN went into code orange. And then as of January 13th, 2022, they're now in code red, which is pretty much a lockdown situation, only essential people in and out. Otherwise, unfortunately, we can't access and have visits within the community. So again, connectivity issues, which we've mentioned a couple of times, that meant that certain types of activities could not be carried out through Zoom. So as such, the level of interaction limited the success of the activities and its purpose to presenting it either as an activity meant to strengthen memory or one to help meaningfully pass the time through exercise or hobbies was definitely impacted. However, what we were able to do was develop a calendar of events that was initially intended to be in person, and then we were able to pivot and host some of those activities over Zoom. The calendar was created to enhance elder activities and to introduce the Friday support group for our elders and their caregivers. The calendar also included traditional activities such as drumming, art, sharing circles, and the community worker, Adrian in this case, was facilitating those events. With this project, we also had an elders advisory group from each of the different communities involved. And in OCN, they were very active and supported the project, told a lot of people about it, and they really supported the ongoing research and skill development of the community worker within the site. And then finally, there was support from a lot of other OCN community groups that enabled continued growth of the program when the funding allowed. So for example, we had some collaboration with the OCN Recreation Department for some elder outings. So some really great success, even though we had quite a few challenges with COVID and connectivity. And that leads us into our final presentation, which again, Tracy was hoping to be here today, but she's had some issues connecting as well. And she was going to tell us a little bit about Saigeen. So what I'll share with you is just some of the experiences that I've had working with Saigeen. So Saigeen is located along the Winnipeg River and Traverse Bay and holds territory in the southern part of Lake Winnipeg. It's approximately 120 kilometers or 75 miles north of the city of Winnipeg, as well as on the mainland. And there's over 3,600 members living on reserve and about 4,500 living off of reserve. What's interesting about Saigeen is it's split between the North Shore and the South Shore, with traditional and Christian ways of life being practiced on either side. So what this brought about was a bit of a challenge, because that meant any meetings, events, workshops, sessions, any kind of sessions that we needed to hold, we actually needed to look at holding them twice, one on one side and one on the other. And there were times when just part of Saigeen was locked down, but the other part wasn't. So again, being able to go into the community and connect with the community due to the lockdown of COVID was a little bit challenging. However, we did actually have a great meeting with the Saigeen elders, and the project is just getting underway with the community planning for dementia education workshops and risk mitigation strategies, and interest to participate and learn more about how the activities can be designed specifically for the community is quite high. So we're excited to move forward with Saigeen on unfolding the project in the coming months. So where do we go from here? Our goal will continue developing resource material, which will lead to knowledge translation and application in the community's native tongues. We will continue with the gift of memories, engaging the elders to preserve their legacy in a modern way. And finally, we'll advocate for sustainability of service delivery that focuses on the culturally tailored, community-led, community-driven approach to supporting those living with dementia and their caregivers. I think out of all of the themes that we found, that was the most important, is how much the project needs to be designed specifically for the communities that we're living and working with. Thank you very much for listening to our presentation today.
Well, I'd like to extend a sincere thanks to the project teams that presented today. That was just amazing. And you can see, when you're presenting, it's always harder to keep an eye on the chat, but there's a lot of activity in the chat. People are interested in having copies of the slides and access to a recording. So all of those will be made available shortly after today. So a sincere thanks for sharing your projects. It's really clear that people are very excited about them. So we're going to now open it up for some questions. We've had a few that have been posted in the Q&A at the bottom of your Zoom screen. So feel free to put questions there. A couple of questions that we did answer already. So one, there was a clarification about whether Myrna was part of the community advisory committee, and yes, she is, although she is also part of two of the dementia community investment projects. So very, very busy and active within the CDLRN. Let's see. So I wonder if I might be able to ask Myrna the first question. So one of the questions, Myrna, that we received, some people were asking about advice for engaging people with dementia. So if you're an organization or a group, and maybe you haven't had a lot of experience doing that, what advice would you give?
Yeah, currently that's the $64,000 question. Excuse me. I've been lucky enough to be part of an organization in BC, where one of our universities is trying to create an organization where people doing research and people from dementia land who want to be part of research can actually touch base. And I think that needs to be done at our level at CDLRN as well. Honestly, a lot of folks with dementia want to do something with the time that we've got. We want to make changes to the world, and we don't know where to begin. So I think that's a very important point, and we should find an answer to that question.
Great. I'm wondering if Valentina or Maribel or anyone from Maribel's team has any other ideas, things that maybe they've tried that has worked well in terms of engaging people living with dementia. Any other thoughts?
Hello.
Hey, Erin.
Hi. You know, when I go in the community, when I said that I have reshifted my focus to do one-on-one, I'm actually a healthcare aide as well. So, you know, I was actually able to go inside and, you know, just kind of sit down with people and observe their body language. You observe the way they, you know, treat you at the door, they greet you, the way they look at you, if they even look at you, you know, and to try and ask somebody is hard. It's really hard. I had one gentleman who I went to visit, and his hand was shaking a little like this. And I noticed that. And on our second visit, I asked him, unfortunately he was my uncle, but I asked him and I said, "Uncle," I said, "why is your hand shaking?" And he said, I'm making myself do this. And, you know, as a worker, I'm not sure how to engage and say, you know, I really see something with you, uncle, but how would you, you know, without trying to overstep, without trying to, you know, offend people, how would you, you know, address that? That is a very good question.
As a person with dementia, I would say the more direct you can be with me and honest, we often, those of us with dementia, get kind of talked down to, and we don't deserve that. We would really like you to be upfront and honest and let us make our own decision.
Great. Thanks, Myrna. Going to go to a couple of other questions that we had. So one of the questions was whether for the two project teams, SE Health and the University of Manitoba, whether, and perhaps it's, well, it's actually probably both, did the communities have local radio stations that could help with the dissemination of the project? So I wonder, okay, Valentina, maybe do you want to speak to that?
I think that is a wonderful idea, and I'm definitely going to write it down. We haven't done something like that so far, but always welcoming new ways to disseminate our findings. So thank you for that suggestion.
Yeah, it's one of the benefit of these types of events, right? You can always learn as well. Maribel or your team, have you had the opportunity to use, is there access to radio stations? And is that a way to get the word out about the project?
I think there are access. I think probably Erin or Emily may speak to this, or Adrian, I see you're able to come onto the call again. It really is difficult with some of the technology in the rural remote areas that we were in particular, once you're higher than a particular parallel. I can't remember the parallel number now off the top of my head. But what we found in all of our projects is it really was about that coming together and gathering and word of mouth. So even putting up a poster at, let's say, if there was a church that we put a poster up at, or a community center, about some of the dementia workshops or sessions that we were holding, it really didn't attract the number of people that we were looking at. However, once we had the community workers go directly to families or to the homes, or there's one community, I believe it's Lake Manitoba, that has community breakfast that they have every 3 weeks on a Friday. Once we had someone go there and start talking a little bit about the project, that's how we were able to get the word around and have the interest in the project peaked. Otherwise, it was a little bit of perhaps mistrust might be too strong of a word, but a little bit of that around technology and how that's supposed to be integrating into their everyday lives. Because it's funny, there's the use of the cell phones and Facebook, but anything beyond that, there was a little bit of questioning as to, well, are you sure this is the right way to go? So, but it we haven't tried the radio station. I think that might be something to look forward to and try in our future.
Great. Thanks, Maribel. And I'm going to follow up, or perhaps even ask Erin this question. There was a question about the community workers in the First Nations communities. And so Joanna was wondering if you could explain who they were and how they're trained. Is that something that you can speak to?
Is that a question for me?
Yes, so I think it's somebody from the U Manitoba team.
Oh, that would probably be more for Maribel there, the ones who
Sure. So as I mentioned, Reg, who is the project lead, actually connected with the health directors. And the health directors kind of did a e-scan of their community to determine who would be the best person to lead this project on site. And so that's kind of how the community workers were established. There wasn't really a recruiting or, kind of a posting or that sort of thing in terms of trying to figure out who the community workers were. They were really determined by the health centers, who had their finger on the pulse of what the community might need. And then from there, the community workers connected with myself, and I went through a little bit of an onboarding training and kind of just went over the parameters of the project, what we thought the measurable outcomes and milestones would be that we wanted to reach, and where we wanted to go in terms of data collection and adding to the framework of service care delivery that the project will eventually produce. But from there, the community workers actually designed how they wanted to reach those measurable outcomes and milestones on their own. So in some communities, they started with puzzles and activities, maybe some stretching exercises. One community tried a little bit of a walking club, so they wanted to include exercise. One of the drawbacks, of course, in living in a rural remote community is there's no sidewalks. So trying to have a walking club didn't quite work. As well, there's wildlife. So you might be walking down the street and actually see a wolf in the forest, because that's you're bordering that that environment. So it really was a bit free-flowing in that sense, as far as the training is concerned, but the initial choosing of the community worker was very much through the health center and the community. Great. Did that answer the question?
Yes, I think it does. And, I think it highlights as well the need to really think about each community differently and uniquely and determine together with them what is going to work best. So yeah, no, I think that that's terrific. There's a question that I would like to ask Valentina. So a question from Tere. Have you identified any community themes or capacities that are essential for developing community strategies to make an impact on dementia?
That is an excellent question. Thank you for posing it. I think that at the end of the day, it's a bottom-up approach or a community-driven approach always works best. There's never a one-size-fits-all, but if there were any pointers, it's like listening to communities and adapting to what they need and to what they ask for and being flexible with timelines and formats of things are, I think, the foundation to being able to develop resources that are useful and that serve their intended purpose.
Great, thank you. Let's see. So I think Valentina, this might be for you as well. And the question is, did you involve family members in your training so that they were aware of what the family member with dementia was dealing with and not just the caregiver?
So in our developed workshops, we did involve caregivers, persons living with dementia, as well as healthcare provider. So it has been kind of like a team effort or a work of the triad, if you may. And then in our current phase, what we're doing is that we're giving people the opportunity to try out the journal. And then we have different surveys or questions for healthcare providers, for persons living with dementia, and for family or friend caregivers, so that we can take everybody's input and improve the journal and measure its impact. So yes.
Great, thanks very much, Valentina. There's a question from Len about whether there are any or many navigator type professions for dementia. So I don't know if there's someone that wants to answer that. I can take a start at that. And then anyone can jump in. So there are, you know, certain countries have designated navigator roles for dementia. The UK would be one of those examples, in Australia as well, I believe. You know, obviously here in Canada, it's provincial, so things can be different from province to province. I know Ontario the best, but my understanding is that there aren't specific navigators in most of the provinces specific to dementia. However, there are multiple individuals and that play that navigator role. So for example, people at the Alzheimer's Society, like a first link coordinator, if the individual or the family is connected to some type of home care support service, then there's usually case managers that can take on that type of role. Family doctors can sometimes be a good resource, or their teams. So so there's not often a designated role, but it's, you know, it's often split. That can be a, you know, there's pros and cons to that. So it definitely would be nice if there were designated navigators. So I don't know if anybody wants to add to that. It's a great question, Len. Let's just say that. Okay. I want to just ask, or one that's not even actually a question. Well, it's sort of a question per se, but there's a few questions, comments about individuals living with dementia participating in research and opportunities to find out about research, including non-clinical research. And those are really great questions. So there's been one suggestion actually, that's a different suggestion. There's a couple of suggestions that I would make. So the Alzheimer's Society of Canada does have a list on its website that does have some information about some research projects that are taking place. So that could be something that you look at. And it really then is dependent on researchers to put that up and to share that information with the Alzheimer's Society of Canada. The Research Institute for Aging, we also try to have at least some information up about research projects that we are aware of. So that might be another resource for you to look at. And in addition to participating as a research participant, so as an individual you collect information from, there's also some opportunities to be a partner. So like Myrna, Myrna's involved in working together with researchers in, you know, defining what questions we should ask and designing research studies and providing advice on, you know, how to deal with issues or challenges that might arise as we undertake a project. So we call those research partners. And on the Research Institute for Aging website, we have some resources that we've developed with people living with dementia and care partners about being involved as a research partner. So those are other ones that you might want to check out. And what we can do is, along with sending the links to the slide and the recordings, we can also provide those links to the Alzheimer's Society website and our website at the Research Institute for Aging. All right. I see that we are almost at our time and we want to be respectful of everyone's time. And we know people tend to go from meeting to meeting. So I would like to extend a sincere thanks to all of our presenters for sharing information about their projects with us. It was so wonderful to hear about the projects and the details and the excellent work that is happening. I'd also like to thank each of you for attending the Discover CDLRN session today. We hope you've gained a better understanding of the Dementia Community Investment Initiative and the role that CDLRN is playing to support the excellent work that's being done by the Dementia Community Investment Projects. On the slide, you'll have a link to the CDLRN website. So that's a way that you can stay informed about the progress of the projects and the learning that's being generated. Of course, we would love to have some feedback on our event today. So we will provide a link in the chat, but we will also send a link in a follow-up email. So with that, I will call this meeting to a close. Thank you again for attending and have a wonderful day.